Today, I'm going to be talking to you about fear not the calling. Fear not the calling. What does that mean? Well, if you're not supposed to be afraid of the calling, that means you're called. And God is a calling on your life. And the callings are different, but then some callings are universal for everyone. All of us have the same callings in some ways. Often when we think of calling, we think of full-time ministry. And in a way, that makes it easier for us to excuse ourselves because God didn't call you to full-time ministry. He called me to full-time ministry, something that I wasn't very excited about at all. As a matter of fact, not only excited, I just wasn't ready to accept it. But God called me to that, and he has a way of doing things. He really does. Altogether, God is calling you for a work in His kingdom. God has a calling for each and every one of us, individually as well as collectively. And we're going to discuss some of these callings today. I want us to go to the Word, 1 Thessalonians. Let's stand for the Word. 1 Thessalonians, chapter 5, and verse 24. Just one verse. But we're going to read this verse, and I want you to hear this word as we read it. Remember that God doesn't call you to read the word, He calls you to hear the word. So I want you to hear the word as we read it. Faithful is He that calleth you, who also will do it. I'm going to read that again and hear Him. Faithful is He that calleth you, who also will do it. Now God calls you to do something, and after this morning service, you're going to find out what God has called you to do. If you do not already know it, and you're going to hear that. I'm going to read that once more. 1 Thessalonians 5:24. Faithful is He that calleth you, who also will do it. I want you to say this with me. Faithful is He that calls me, who also will do it. Thank you, Jesus. We pray Your blessings upon this message, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. God calls us in different ways. Today is Mission Sunday, and we honor those that are in the mission field. We honor them with our prayers and with our financial support. We pray for them. And sometimes, you know, God may wake you up in the middle of the night to pray for a particular missionary, to a particular person. Don't worry about what it's about. Just do what God tells you to do. They're in the battlefield. In 1 Samuel chapter 30 and verse 24, he says that God will honor those that stay with the stuff, those that are behind, like you and I. We're not called to go to the ministry. I mean, to go to the mission field. But we stay behind and we guard the stuff. We pray and we give them with finances. And then God says that He will honor us equally as the ones that are out there because we're supporting them. We're making it possible for them to continue in ministry. Many ministries die right here at the calling. Many ministries die here at the calling. In the last 10 months, I've had two people in my office talking to me, young men. And I did not invite them. I did not call them. They called to make an appointment to speak with me. And so we sat down in my office and we talked about, I didn't know what we wanted to talk about. And one of them said, well, you know what it's about. And I said, I have no idea. Tell me, what is this about? He said, well, I'm called to ministry. I said, praise God. And I'm here to help you in every way that I can. So tell me about it. He says, well, I don't want to. I said, well, I cannot help you there. And then we had about an hour discussion. At the end of the discussion, he agreed that he was called to ministry and that he should respond to what God has called him to do. He walked out of my office and he has not come back again, called me, or anything else. The calling is very, many callings, many ministries die right there. Another young man called and I spoke with him and I said, I spoke with you about a year ago. And he said, yes, sir, you did. I said, and so now what are we going to talk about? He said, well, kind of the same thing. I said, why haven't you responded? I said, it's fear, huh? He said, yes, sir, it is. I'm scared. I said, son or young man, I said, it's not easy to respond to the calling of God, because he may tell you to do things that are contrary to what you want. And you may want to wait for things to get just right before you do them. You respond to God when he calls you to respond to God. He called me to respond. He called me to the ministry. I did not want to be in the ministry. He told me to close my business. I closed my business. I didn't sell it. He told me to move to a very fine place called 1620 Pin Road. It was awful and ugly. Ugly. Johnson grass all over the place, mesquite, weesash, not lions, but we had a lot of snakes. A lot of possums and a lot of creatures that I had never seen before, a lot of things that I had never seen before, little insects that I'd never seen before, nor my wife. I told my wife, we're going to do this, and I've been called to the ministry. And I told my children. Well, my son was excited because there was a lot of things to hunt out here and do things, so that was okay with him, but not for my wife nor for my older daughter. So I said, pray. We came to the grounds. It was terrible. And she told me to pray again. And I said, I already prayed. I said, you pray. If I didn't hear God, we'll stop right here. We had already started our ministry in the garage. God had called me to start our ministry to be a pastor. I went and studied, got my license, and prayed. And I didn't know who I was going to go with, and God said, just, I'm going to lead you. So he did. I was very faithful to our church. I was a leader in the church. My wife was also part of the leadership. And God told me to start the church, and I told the pastor one time that God had called me. And I said, but know this. I read the scripture. The scripture says not to build your ministry upon someone else's foundation. So I said, I'm not going to. So I came and talked to the church. The pastor introduced me, announced that I was going to be into the ministry. And my legs were trembling. But I said, yes, I am. And I told the church, we're going to start a church. And I'm going to ask you not to come. I said, if this is of God, he will send the people. And if it's me, then it'll die very soon and I'll be back in a few Sundays. And that's the fact. And I didn't want anyone to come there because the people that were going to come to our church were people that were going to be from that God was sending. I had no idea how he was going to do that. But there's a man sitting over there. Zorba, would you wave your hand? There it is. There's one guy. From the very beginning, in the garage of our house. His name's not Zorba. His name is Joe Martinez. But he was introduced to me as Zorba when he first came into the garage. He was a sound man for a very, very, very well-known Latino band. And God just relieved him from that duty. And there was another fellow there who used to play the saxophone for a very well-known Latino band by the name of Tony Rodriguez. There he is right there. Wave your hand. And there were some others. And through a series of circumstances that I won't go into it right now, our ministry started, and they started coming, and then pretty soon they left the band. He left the band. They couldn't play anymore for the world, and we were in the garage. And then everything just happened. We praise God for all those things. Amen. He plays the guitar now, but he also plays the keyboard, and he also plays the drums, but his first instrument was the saxophone. And so God just began to do things in our ministry, and this is the calling. But the calling is not easy. Many ministries die right here at the calling. Those two young men, one has not contacted me again at all. The other one occasionally does, but they don't want to continue or to even start. It's difficult. It's difficult to do that. It's easy to build on somebody else's ministry, on somebody else's foundation. But God said, you build on your foundation, not someone else's. And he says that several times in Scripture. So praise the Lord. Abraham, his name was Abram. And God told him to get out of his place and going to a country that he had never been to before, to a people whose language he could not speak, and to go there. So he did. Took his wife and a nephew with him by the name of Lot. So they went and started a place. He became the father of faith. Your father and my father of faith. So the Bible tells us in the Old and New Testament. Father Abraham. He responded to God. God's calling is a response to God, not to man. I responded to God. I told my wife that we're going to come here. She said, okay. We were not jumping at the opportunity because it was very, very ugly here at that time. This is where people threw their dumped their trash on the streets. And this is, there were no sidewalks, no lights, no streets. I mean, the streets were narrow. There were no bridges where you see bridges. So when it rained, we were just bound here. We couldn't get out because everything was, we were flooded from this area, from that area, and from that area. So we couldn't go anywhere if it rained. We waited until the rain went down, and the waters went down. And God said, you're going to be the light there. And sure enough, he has done a lot of changes in this area, and I praise God for that. The Lord told us we were going to go west. And so I told my wife, we're going to go west. And my wife said, yay, we're going to go west. So, but we didn't know what west meant. So we got in the car and drive, and we thought we were going to go to Helotes Park Estates. And there were nice mountain homes there. We lived in Oak Hills. It was a very nice area. And so I said, well, yeah. And God said, no, not there. I said, well, maybe San Antonio Ranch. God said, no, not there. So one day I'm making a call. I was a businessman at the time, and I was making a call to Lackland Air Force Base. And I made the wrong turn, but it was the right turn. And I ended up on West Commerce, which is right up back this way. And it dead ended on Penn Road. Couldn't go any further. So I said, man, I got to get out of this way, out of this place. It's terrible. So I turned. I go to the creek. I had to get to a street. There were no streets. The only street was a little bitty old narrow street there called Marbach Road. It was two lanes, just no sidewalks, nothing, just a creek bed. And God said, I'm going to turn here. So I turned. And as soon as I turned, God spoke to me audibly for the first time in my life. And he said, turn around, there's your new home. I hit the brakes, I stopped on the creek bed, and I began to cry. And I said, God, is that you? He said, turn around, there's your new home. So I turned around, and I saw this place that was not pretty at all. An old rundown house, a shack, a farmhouse that was condemned to be torn down, no windows, shutters flapping in the wind. And God said, this is your new home. Long story short, we moved in here. And we did things. The calling. God said, close your business, so I closed it. How are you going to make a living? Well, faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. And you have to understand that. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. And you have to respond to that. You don't wait until you have everything ready and now I can go. You go when he calls you. He called Abraham. He told him to go and he went. Praise God. God told him to sacrifice his son. And he was willing to do so. Why? Because he trusted God. God told us your latter days will be better than your former days. So, I had to trust God. Now, when things were rough, very rough, financially, I had to remember that God said, your latter days will be better than your former days. Thank you, Father. You said it. It's going to happen. And it has happened, but it takes time. I can give you many, many testimonies, but that's not important. The important thing is, faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. Pastor Darrell was saying a moment ago, talking about finances, or not finances, but your offerings. God says, I'm calling you to do this. Do it. I'm not picking an offering. I always say this after with the offering. So I don't want you to feel like I'm preparing you for an offering, because I don't do that. But faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it. You have to do that. You have to wait for God and do what God tells you. Isaac, he had a son named Isaac. Married a woman named Rebecca. Never seen her before in his life. But God told his servant, "That's you're the one." And that's the way God did it. He had a son. Two sons. Jacob and Esau. Rebecca called Jacob to be the leader. He was already called by God. But she took matters into her own hand. Don't respond to mama's calling. Don't respond to daddy's calling. Respond to God's calling. What does God say? What did God tell you to do? That's what you respond to. Fear not the calling. Don't be afraid of the calling. It gets tough sometimes. I could give you a lot of testimonies about that. I could write a book on that. But the best book that I can write, I couldn't write because it's already here. He says, "Faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it." You've heard me say this before, and I'll say it again many, many more times. How long do you trust God? Until when do you trust God? Only until the last second. After that, you don't have to trust him anymore. He says, once you do what he tells you, and you've done it, you don't have to worry about it anymore because you've done your part. God will always do his. And don't ever try to trade off with God. "Well, God, I'll do this if..." You don't say that to the king. "God, I'll do that because you told me to." Faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it. Jacob did that and got in trouble until he met the angel of God. God gave him a new name. God's given you a new name. Begin to do what he tells you to do and respond. Don't be afraid. There's a fellow by the name of Saul. He was a big fellow. He was head and shoulders taller than all the other fellows. And he was shy and bashful. And God called him to be king, the first king of Israel. He didn't want to be king. But he became king, and then he got to his head. God called him to be a king, but he didn't call him to be a priest. So he took matters on his own and took the task of a priest. He got in trouble with God. He ended up asking counsel of witches as a result of disobeying God. Faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it. Don't set up yourself to what you want to do. I had my plan. You know, I was a young businessman, and I had your five-year plan. I had all those things down. I knew that I was going to do something by a certain age. By 35, I'm 36, I'm going to be a millionaire, and that's the way it is. And I was working towards that. I owned my own business, and I worked for corporate America. Then I went to my own business, and here I am, and I'm going to do it. And God says, "Ven acá, chico." He says, "Come here, kid." So you respond to him, and he changes things. Faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it. There was another Saul by the name of Saul of Tarsus. His mom and dad sent him to live with his older sister in Jerusalem so he could study under a great teacher by the name of Gamaliel. And he went and learned a lot of things. Great, great mind. In fact, he wrote half the New Testament. But it was not until he began to respond to God's calling. Because he responded to his emotions. A lot of people respond to their emotions. God doesn't deal with my emotions. He deals with my spirit. God has never asked me, "Gilbert, how do you feel about doing this?" He has never asked me that. And he never will. He'll just say, "Gilbert, I want you to do this." This is how God deals with you. And we're going to see some instances in just a moment. And this is where your calling comes in. God may not call you to preach. God may not call you to be a pastor. But I had a calling, and you have a calling. And it's amazing. Sometimes God will tell you to do things at the most inopportune times. I shared with you a couple of Sundays ago, or last Sunday or sometime, how, you know, I like my boots. I always like dress boots. I don't wear cowboy boots, but I wear these kind of boots. And so I had saved money for my boots. And then God, at the most inopportune time, tells me, give your money to that man. That's unfair. I've been saving my fives and my ones and my twosies and my threesies and my fives until I got enough money. And I had it in my wallet in a certain spot for my boots. And God said, give it to that man. That was my calling at the moment, and it was not an opportune time. It was not well planned at all. God will sometimes call you to do things at the most inopportune time. There was a famine in the land. There was a famine in the land of Israel. And God tells this widow, I want you to prepare some food because I'm going to send a man to see you. The name of Elijah. And he goes there. And God, there's famine. And then God tells him, go over there to Zarephath because there's a widow there. And she's going to prepare food for you. So she goes over there. And here she is preparing her last morsel of food so that she and her son can die, can eat and then die. They were starving. And the man of God comes by in there, and I'm paraphrasing it, of course. But he comes by and he says, by the way, I'm here to eat your last meal. Well, that doesn't sound very well. It doesn't sound very nice. But God told him to do that, but he had prepared her to do that. She was the one that was called to do something for the man of God. Sometimes God will tell you to do things for someone else. Not necessarily a man of God, but he'll tell you to go and do this or that for someone else. And it may not be the most opportune time. And God had already told her, you're going to be feeding this man. When you respond to the calling, you will not lack. I have never lacked. Some of you do not know this, and some of you do, but I'll just tell you this once more. Please bear with me. Years ago, Christine was a baby. My son and my daughter went to school. And my wife comes and tells me, there's no food for lunch. There's no food. And I said, did you feed the children breakfast? He said, they had breakfast, but we have no food for lunch. And I said, what time do you prepare lunch? He said, at 10:30. I begin preparing lunch. And I said, well, it's not 10:30 yet. I went about my chores here in the ministry. Right about that time, before 10:30, a real cowboy, this guy used to break horses and run a ranch, was a foreman with a big ranch here on Highway 90. He got saved. I baptized him in the river, was very faithful to church. And he comes in, drives up in a little station wagon. And he starts walking like, you know how cowboys walk. You know, he walks like this. And I'm saying, what's the matter, Tony? He says, well, I don't know. I said, tell me, what's up? I thought he was needed something. He said, I don't know. He said, I feel bad. Okay? I said, okay. So he said, come. So we go to the back of the station wagon. There's the key. He picks up the thing and gives me a sack full of groceries. And as I'm holding it, he closes it and drives off. I'm saying, man, what is this? Now, we don't have any food anymore. But faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it. I go to the back of the house, the kitchen, the old farmhouse that's not there anymore. That was our home there for 25 years, what is now the daycare. But that was not the original home. The original home was the old farmhouse that we moved in. It was a big difference from our home before. So I say, what time is it? My wife says, 10:30. Just enough. It was a sack full of groceries. This is the way God works. Faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it. When do you? How long do you wait? Only till the last second. What's going to happen after that? That's his business, not my business. He's in production. I'm just in sales. He's the one that does the production. All I do is preach the word. And then I live the word. And you do that in everything. Faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it. When I was wearing secondhand clothes and secondhand shirts, I used to wear tailor-made suits before that. When I was wearing those kind of shirts, hand-me-downs, or somebody dropped them off, and I still have one left. I have my cowboy hat. Yeah, that one. I have that hat, and I still have it. Somebody left it here. And God kept saying, your latter days will be better than your former days. So I put on the shirt that was a little bit big for me or a little bit too tight. But I would remember, my latter days will be better than my former days. And they have been. I can give you many, 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 many stories. But you trust God, and you only trust him until the last second. Praise the Lord. So the widow is there, and he says, I come to eat. And she prepares him the last meal to him. What's the deal about this? She knew her calling. She knew her calling. Her calling was to feed the man of God when he came by there. There's another woman. God has did a lot of things with women. You know, God's not a male chauvinist. But there's a place for women and a place for men, obviously. But anyway, that on that some other time. It's all here. I found it there. So she feeds him, and then she says, go get some more oil on a cruse. I don't know if you know what a cruse is. But here's the cruse. It was not a can. It was not a bucket. It was a cruse, like a saucer. She said, it'll never run out. And from there, she just made and had oil and everything else left over. God always, always will take care of you. Just do what he tells you. He'll take care of your health. He'll take care of you. He's God. And he never runs out of anything. Sometimes God's callings are in very inopportune times. You're called to prayer. You are all called to prayer. You're called to witness. God says you are a chosen generation. Last year, I wrote a little booklet. It's called Witnessing in the 21st Century. They're in the bookstore. I urge you to get one and read it. They're $5. If you don't have the money, just take one and tell them you don't have the money, they'll give it to you. But read it. Witnessing in this century, the 21st century, is no more difficult than it was in the first century. In the first century, people were getting killed for being Christians. They were being crucified for being Christians. People are being killed in this century for being Christians. People are being persecuted. You're called to witness. You're called to witness. This week, yesterday, I believe it was, or maybe it was Friday, I witnessed one of the greatest testimonials from an NBA, National Basketball Association basketball coach. His name is Monty Williams, I believe is his name. At a time when his wife got killed by someone who ran into her, he stood up there and gave the greatest testimony that I have ever heard to our Lord Jesus Christ. We knew, and I know that it was not fake. Let me tell you how I know that. About 15 years or so ago, he was in San Antonio for a short time. His wife applied for a job, a teaching job, at Sunnybrook Christian Academy, and they came here once or twice. But then they got moved out of town. And she came here and she told my wife, please do not, I'm going to give you my maiden name. I'm not going to give you my last name, my husband's name, because I don't want people to think, you know, they're going to come to me because I'm the wife of Monty Williams, the basketball player. He was a very good basketball player before he became coach. They were that kind of humble people. They were like that. That was her testimony. She was a strong woman of God. Strong woman of God. It was a joy talking to her and talking to him. Men of God and women, they give a great testimony about how, you know, she was killed instantly. She left five children. And here he is praying and asking for prayer for the other woman that hit her who also died. I mean, and saying she's in a better place than we are now. And she's in a place where we all want to go someday. I mean, great testimony. See, that's what his calling is. Many people say, well, my calling is to play basketball or to do this or to do that. Your calling is to witness for Jesus Christ. All of you are called to witness to the Lord Jesus Christ and for the Lord Jesus Christ. Whatever you do, you say, well, they don't let me talk where I work. No, but they let you work where you work, right? If they let you work where you work, work like a Christian. Go beyond. Go walk the second mile. When your boss doesn't like what you do and tells your name, turn the other cheek. And preach what Peter calls the silent sermon. I know what it's like. And I know what it's like to be on this side of Christianity and to be in where I am now. Before Christianity, I'd go downtown and there'd be young people out there witnessing in the corner of St. Mary's and the Commerce and Houston Street, and they'd be handing out tracts, and they'd give me a tract and I would take it and they wouldn't say anything to me. There used to be a big billiard parlor, two of them, right downtown. And one of them was my favorite, good gambling place there. And I'd go there. And sometimes they'd be outside and they'd throw, and I just, years later when I became a Christian, that same place became a place called the Catacombs, where we would go there and preach and pass out tracts and sing Christian songs there in the same place. And I'd take the musicians sometimes with me. And we'd all get in the van and go out there and go in there. The same corner where I would crumple down tracts is the same place where now we were handing them out. See, that's my calling. That's your calling. That's what you're called to do. You're called to be a preacher. God says, go into all the world, into Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the outermost parts of the world. You start at your house. Why? The most difficult place to preach is to your brother who's not saved, or to your sister who is not saved, or to your mother who is not saved, or to your father who is not saved, or to your son who is not saved, or to your daughter who is not saved. How do I know? I know it very well. I had six brothers. There were seven of us in my family, seven boys, no girls. And I'm the only one that got saved first. I know what it's like. But you start in Jerusalem, and then you go. You're called. How do you overcome the fear? In the book of Hebrews, and I won't keep you here much longer than this, But in the book of Hebrews, he uses the word rest over and over and over again. The word rest. In Hebrews 13 and verse 16, he says, I'm going to read it in just a moment, but right now, you're called to witness, to communicate. Tell others about Christ. Tell others about Christ. Will you be chastised for it? Possibly. No. Really, you will. Because the world hates Christ and God. And Jesus said, they hated me and they'll hate you. He says, but beware when the world likes you. Now that sounds kind of eerie. You mean it's not good for the world to like me? Uh-uh. Because if the world likes me, that means I'm not doing Jesus' job. So learn to witness. Learn to talk to someone. That's why I put this together. It was going to be a little booklet. And then it was going to be a big book. And then the Holy Spirit takes and says, people will not read big books. We don't like to read now. We like to watch things on TV or in a video or something. So I just wrote this little one. It's pretty good. KSLR had a meeting of women leaders and pastors' wives, and they got one of these books for every lady that was there. So it's a pretty good book. It sells for whatever, but we'll do it for $5 at the store. If you don't have it, that's okay. Get the book. Tell them you don't have the money. And it's all right. It's not about money. It's about passing the word. Let God be Lord of everything. Pass the word. But you're afraid. Sometimes it's fearful. In Hebrews 13 and verse 16 says, but to do good and to communicate, forget not. Don't forget to witness. Don't forget to communicate. For with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. What sacrifices is he talking about? To do good and to communicate. Those are sacrifices because there's times when you don't want to do good. There's been times when you don't want to do good. Has that ever happened to you? It happens to us sometimes. You know, you go to eat and you got this waiter or this waitress and they got an attitude and they're doing you a favor and you want to say, maybe she's having a bad day. And sometimes I'll say, oh, you're having a hard day? God will bless you. Can I pray for you quietly? And I've had more than one say, yes, thank you. That's the end of that. But to do good and to communicate is good. Enter into his rest. Why? In Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 3, it ends up with saying this. He says, for we which have believed do enter into rest, as he said, as I have sworn in my wrath. This is God speaking. As I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. He's already done the work. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to witness. Don't be afraid to tell others. Don't be afraid. And sometimes you'll be rejected. I made a trip to Mexico, Monterrey, Mexico, one time. And I used to go there very regularly because I had a distributor when I was in business. One of my distributors was in Monterrey, another one in Acapulco, another one in Mexico City. So I used to go there regularly. But this time I just went just to go see my brother and tell him about Jesus. When I told him I was coming, when I got there, he was not there. He left for the country. He went to his ranch. I said, but I told him I was coming. He says, that's why he left. Sometimes you'll get rejected. But later on, he bowed down. It took a while. Your job is to communicate and to do good. Witness. Tell others about Jesus. We're living in a very difficult time. And sometimes the only way to tell somebody about Jesus is by doing good. With your boss, who may not be a believer, you do good. He says, what's the matter? Why don't you do that? Are you deaf or something? I'm sorry, I didn't hear you, sir. Do that. He said, are you afraid of him? No. God says, do good and communicate, and you'll win him for eternity. Sometimes Peter says you have to preach a silent sermon. And sometimes you have to preach a silent sermon when you don't want to preach it. His calling is sometimes comes at very inopportune times. And God will never ask you, how do you feel about this? He never will. The king only tells you, I want you to do this. Praise God. Let's stand and be dismissed, shall we? Fear not the calling. God calls you. I can just imagine that widow Zarephath. I'm sure she was scared. You want me to give you my last meal? Yes. And as a result, she had enough to give to her neighbors. Don't be afraid. Serve God. Minister to Him. Minister to Him. Learn to do good. Learn to communicate. And sometimes the only way you can communicate is with your actions. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Lord, I thank you and I praise you. I pray, mighty God, your blessings upon your people here this evening, this morning. Father, I'm praying, and I want to speak to those that may not know you, Father. There may be one or two persons here who has never called on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You do not know what it is to be a son or a child of God. If there is such a person here this morning, just raise your hand and put it right down. I want to pray with you. Praise the Lord. We have a job to do, church. We have to go out and bring him in. We have to go out and witness and tell others about the good news that there's an eternal God. And we're going to do good and communicate. Father, I speak blessings, Father, upon your people, Father. I speak blessings of hearing. Lord God, that they hear you. That they hear you when you call them. That they can respond to your calling. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.